feel like this whole topic is probably a better discussion, especially for folks who've had dairy cows or have dairy cows, or even if you're planning on getting a dairy cow in the future. So what kind of experience do you guys have with dairy cow, with dairy cattle? Do you guys have any experience? Adventures actually started because of my husband. He was born and raised in Wisconsin and worked on a dairy farm. And so, lo and behold, now we have dairy cattle. So, Ivan, what kind of experience do you have?
Well, I grew up in milk cows around the world. A big imprint in my life was milking the cow.
Right.
And, you know, that started off when I was little, of course. You know, milk everything by hand, and then we went to a, you know, the certified cow milker, and moved right on with that. But that, I definitely left that part of the farm in 62.
Okay.
So, I mean, definitely an imprint. And between Linda and I, we bring about 4 or 5 gallons of milk, a week, so I never ever got a week.
Okay. Well, so, this whole presentation will probably just go better if we all can kind of talk and instead of me just talking to you. So that's the way it's been kind of built here. So the first thing is before you even start milking before you even consider having a dairy cow, is to have a plan. So a dairy cow will give you a lot of milk very quickly. So we keep a calf on our cows all the time. So part of our milk is going to the calf, but we still get 4 gallons of milk a day. So with 4 gallons of milk, we put them in these half gallon jars. That's 8 jars of milk in my refrigerator. So you can imagine after a couple of days, my refrigerator is like packed full, right? So some things to think about is remembering that milking is an everyday adventure. If you don't milk every day, you're gonna get illnesses, sicknesses, things like that. And then how are you gonna do it? Are you gonna sometimes have a calf on her? Are you gonna milk twice a day just to make sure she doesn't get mastitis? Some other things is, what are you gonna do? How are you gonna milk? Are you gonna milk by hand? Are you gonna get a milking machine? There are pros and cons to both. So hand milking, you can get a little more debris in there. Machine milking, you can wear out the teats a little faster. So there's just some things to think about what fits your lifestyle. So what are you gonna do with all your milk, and do you have enough storage? We ended up actually getting a second refrigerator to store the milk in, just because my regular refrigerator just couldn't hold it all. And then what are you gonna do with your milk? Like, are you gonna make cheese? You want all the stuff that you're gonna do with your milk, all the extras. So if you're gonna make cheese, you're gonna wanna make sure you have your remnant on hand, things like that, so it's available as soon as your milk is fresh and cooled, that you can move right on to the next step. And then something else to think about before you even get a dairy cow is, where are you gonna milk? So are you gonna tie your dairy cow up to the fence and get down really low on a bench and do it? Or are you gonna have a stanchion so you can actually sit on a bench? Those are just little things that people think it sounds great to have a dairy cow, but it's like, where are you gonna go? What are you gonna do with it? Because once you get the cow home and you're milking, there's just a lot of other things that need to fall into place. Making a happy cow. This is one of the biggest things for us is that we've found is that you really want to make sure that you have a happy cow. interesting fact that a lot of people don't know, that a lactating cow, at her peak production, can eat 50 pounds of feed in a day. So 35 to 40 of that could come from hay, with the rest being additional minerals and grain or whatever supplements that you're going to have for added protein. But that's a lot of feed. And then also making sure that they have clean water, because they will drink gallons upon gallons of fresh water. So cows are very social, and this is the other part that I attribute to a happy cow, is we have three dairy cows, or had three dairy cows, and one of them, her name is Ginger, loves my husband. And when my husband milks, he goes up there and he plays some Willie Nelson, and because that's her music choice. And he'll milk with the radio on, and she will just give us all of her milk. On days that I go up there and milk her, she is like, I do not like you. You're only going to get half my milk. And so we can't go very many days without making sure that, or with me milking her. But we have another cow. Her name was Circus, and she recently passed away. But she loved me and the boys. So I could milk her, the boys could milk her. She loved being brushed and handled. But she disliked my husband, and she would give him almost no milk at all. She just wouldn't even let down. She just wouldn't do it. So they're very social like that, and it's important to spend time and figure out what their thing is. Do they like the scratch behind the ear? Do they like being the brush, or, you know, whatever. Do they like music? Do they want you to sing to them? Because once you figure out what makes them happy, then you're their friend forever. And that's when you get good milk, you'll get good milk production, you'll get high cream, if those few things are being met. And I think that kind of could go back to the grouchy cow. You know, she was always mean and nasty, but maybe she just hadn't found her person. So, Ginger, for example, when she has her calf, I have to completely stay out of the corral and away from her and her baby. She will take me, but she won't take my husband. And it's just weird. Like, they just have their things. So even if I go in the pen with her 3 months in, she'll still paw at the ground and let me know that she does not like me. So you kind of just have to find their groove. Yeah.
What did you do?
That's what my husband asked. He's like, you must have hurt her at some point. And I was like, I never, I took her baby, I guess. So, because we keep a calf on them all the time, or half of the day, what we do is at night, we'll put the calf on, and then in the morning, I'll go pull the calves off so that we can milk at night when we get home. And so that's the only thing I can think of, is she just doesn't like me taking her calf away. But she...
And that's your story.
That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. I will say, I do carry a 2x4 with me now. yeah. And then also, you know, another thing is Ginger doesn't like the boys either, or the dogs. So we have to make sure that the children stay, are very aware of her when she's in the corral and we're taking her into milk. And we'll talk more about that later. So the next thing is making sure that you have good milking hygiene. This is my list. So part of having a happy cow is having a routine. So we do the same steps in the same order over and over so that they always know what's coming. They can be relaxed and just be willing to let down and give us their milk. So this is the routine that my husband and I created so that we do it the same every time. And the other thing that this does is it helps us to make sure that we have clean udders, we have clean milk, and when we test our milk, that we're getting the best possible results that we can. So first thing is milk in a clean and stress-free environment. So going back to Ginger, who doesn't like me very much, we try to minimize how often I milk Ginger. So I really only milk Ginger if Jake honestly cannot make it for one reason or another. Other than that, he does it just to make sure she's relaxed and not worked up. The next thing we do is we squirt the first few squirts of milk into a cup or a dish, and we look at that milk for the texture, the smell, the color, to try to head off any signs of mastitis or anything like that. We minimize how much water we actually use on the udder. We don't wash the whole udder, we only wash just the teats. And the reason for that is, think about, you have like, say you have a cow with a dirty udder, like lots of manure, hay, things like that, and now you start adding water and trying to scrub that off. Well, what happens when you dip your finger in water? That drip, you know, it collects kind of right here on the end. Well, that's where the valve is, or the teat, you know, opening is. And so now you're introducing all that bacteria from the udder to the teat, where it can now go right up and in. So we try to minimize how much water we use, but we do take a pail of soapy water up there and then just wring it out so it's damp so we can scrub just the teats off. So then we wash the teats, and then we'll apply like a teat disinfectant. So for us, I tend to be a little more natural, not a lot of chemicals in our milk, or in our milking supplies. So we use iodine and olive oil, and we just give them a quick teat disinfectant, and then we dry them off really well so that they're nice and dry to the touch. And that all goes back to how much moisture and how much water you're introducing to the end of that teat. Because our goal is to not have provide an avenue for things to go back up. So then we go ahead and milk, we'll strip the teats again, and then for the second teat disinfectant, we don't dip like we would on the first one. We actually just spray. We spray it on there so it's a light mist. Goes back to the same thing, just not involving a whole bunch of extra water. So what did you guys used to do, Ivan?
Well, and I guess I should step up too. You know, back in the day, I don't remember disinfecting anything. You know, you want to set up to the cow and went ahead and clean, you know, the teats and then, you know, strip, make sure that things was going and then to business. I never remember us putting any kind of, you know, sanitizing solution on. Like I said, this is back in the 60s, I was pretty small. But I worked on a dairy in Ogden, Utah that we milked 450 cows, we milked 375 all the time. And off of what you were just saying about the water, they had a system set up in the warm weather that was with rainbird, impulse rainbird. And as the cows would come in the mouth, they would wash. Everything was well geared, and so it was on the other areas, and so the whole bag and everything was wet as they come in. So you just had to dry things off and go on through. Then the last thing that we did was, like you say, the dip cups. That was a low percentage iodine dip, and then once we were done melting, then they were dipped with that, and then they were dried, and then they were
left wet. So, I mean, there's a lot of things, and we'll talk a little bit later about testing and kind of the different standards of, like, milk that's tested for bulk production versus testing your milk for
meat consumption. So, what's your iodine olive oil ratio?
So I would have to actually go look, because we buy a diluted iodine, and then I just mix it 50-50. But yeah.
0.5%?
I think it's either 0.5 or 0.7.
Yeah, it's not very much.
No, it's not very much.
Not very.
And the reason I put olive oil in there is just as some extra, like keeping those teats nice and soft. Because as you go into the season, they'll just really start to dry out and crack. Yeah. And sometimes at this one, if their teats really are, I'll put like a lotiony stuff up higher, not like down low, but just up higher to make sure that they're not cracking. And especially in winter, we have to do that.
Do you have any problems with kids chapping in the winter time and say, judge where there is sores on them and that?
Yeah, sometimes we get it. It just depends on how brutal the winter is.
Well, and how aggressive the calf can be too.
Right, yeah. And so that's the other thing. When keeping a calf on there is making sure to wash those teats, because sometimes as they get older, those teats will start to cut those teats. And when they start doing that, we actually pull the calves off and we'll milk them twice a day and then just dump to the calf, just to really protect those teats from. So back in Wisconsin, my husband was like, the dairy farmer that he used to work for was so mad at us for keeping our calves on our cows. So they were like, that's like, no, no, like, don't do that. So supplies and some cleaning. We wash our equipment every time we use it, and we sanitize it every time we use it. So how we do that is we start with lukewarm water when we're done. And the reason you start, you rinse everything out with lukewarm water, and because if you use hot water right away, it'll actually scald those milk proteins onto the stainless steel. So rinse it out first, dump it, and then you can go back in with your super hot water. And then to sanitize, like, this is completely your choice. Like, there's a lot of supplies on the market that you can get for sanitizing your equipment. We just use peroxide. Like, we buy bulk peroxide and that's what we use. Use as much stainless steel equipment as possible. So even our wash bucket that we take up there, just in case we do have manure on our teats, you want that to even be stainless steel, because if you use plastic and you introduce a bacteria to that, that's not going to come as clean every time. So you may be introducing things from one milking to another, where the stainless steel, you clean it, you sanitize it, you can move on. The last thing about cleaning that I would encourage and that I've found through lots of research is that it's better to actually let your stainless steel air dry. You don't want to like dry it with a rag, things like that. It just introduces more bacteria. So pretty straightforward. You guys have any questions or thoughts about this? Cleaning supplies. How much extra bacteria bacteria am I introducing into my cleaning routine? So not taking care of our teats right, not cleaning our equipment, things like that. So these numbers are what I strive for. And this is really different, and I wish I would have pulled that up, and I can for anybody who's interested. But these numbers are a standard in a lot of states that allow the sale of raw milk, okay? So Idaho, really, like, if you're above these numbers, you cannot sell until you have a test that's below those. Now, milk that goes into the bulk tanks that goes to the grocery store, these numbers are way higher for obvious reasons. I mean, they pasteurize everything, they do all that. So those numbers are just to keep people safe. And so personally, I try to do that. That's your guys' own call. Yeah.
Is this the kit that you buy and do it at home, or do you have to send this off to someone?
So I send it off. So I used to send it to Colorado State, and they would test it. But in the fall of 19, they stopped testing them. Now, and I have the link at the end, I send it to, it's called Utter Health in Idaho, and you get a nice little printout sheet. So, and like I said, this is my own thing, but I care about my family, and I want to make sure that what I'm feeding them is as clean as and healthy as it can be.
Then how is that sample sent? Does it send up in a jar?
Yep, so they send you a container, and then they have very specific directions of how to collect your milk, how to put it in a tube, and then you have to package it in ice and overnight it. So,
not really a simple process.
No. And like they say, you know, like you have to make sure when you take your lid off your tube, like you set it upside down, like just so you're not introducing anything extra. And it is kind of an expense, but I feel like it's worth it. So it's about $70 to have these two tests on. And then if my numbers come back higher than this, I will admit I pasteurize my milk. So it's as simple as a double broiler, heating it up to 165 degrees for 15 seconds. So we got a milk cow specifically for the A2A2 proteins. And so that process isn't affected, like those proteins themselves aren't necessarily affected by the pasteurization process. So, you guys have any other questions or input?
Touch on that again. Explain to me what you just said on that age.
Okay, so there's like the proteins in the milk in like most dairy cattle are A1 is what they're called. And so my oldest son has an allergy, and his digestive system just deals better with the A2A2 proteins. And so it's more of a historic type of gene that the cows have.
I've heard of that, but
yeah.
I've never explained.
So we just, that's why we started, is he would have eczema from top to bottom, and he'd go to get in the shower and just cry. But as long as we can keep him in the A2A2 milk, he doesn't get those same reactions.
No, not lactose.
Nope, it's different. No, and I don't know the exact science behind it, but for him, he is gluten intolerant, and so when he has, he goes to school and eats a cupcake, you know, that's when he gets these rashes. But as long as we keep him in the A2A2 milk, it for some reason. Yeah. And the only reason we even start, the only reason we found out is one time one of my friends, Tim Robeson, he was like, hey, you should try this for your son's eczema. So anyway, yeah. So that's
how
when we specifically.
How do you know if a cow or breed has the A2A2 rather than?
It's a simple blood test.
Oh,
wait,
I
do you have any questions?
Okay. We have some Devon. Our public house that we have are Devon.
social creatures, finding out what their little love language is.
I know.
Yeah.
I pretty much have a love language with all our cows. So.
That's good. That's good. That's important. Because, you know, like I said, if I go too many days milking our cow Ginger, you know, she's bound to get mastitis because she won't let down. So, and then the last thing is just make it a family fun affair. So this is, I don't know if you can really see that picture very well. We have four kids on four teats and more milk on the floor than in the bucket. our kids.
How many barn cats do you have to
feed? You what?
How many barn cats do you have that you feed?
Not many. Although it's fun, sometimes we. Sometimes we have a calf over here, and so you, yeah, you can.
Yeah.
So you guys have
a testing that we do, is there $70, is that just one cow, or do you have like a lot of cows?
No, that's one, that's per cow. Yeah. And I do, so you can send them all in together, and it has a process for how to do that. But I want to make sure, like, I do have one in, yeah. And most of the time we're only milking one cow, so we attempt to milk year round. So, you know, we have two go, we'll have one going, and then as we're drying that one off, we have another one coming on. Yeah.
Well, Amanda, have you had any luck with regeneration as far as your heifer calves achieving the 82?
Yep.
I mean, so that's a gene that carries through strong.
Yep. And then
or do you look, is that something you look for in the world?
Yep. Stuff and then Chance helps us to make sure that we've got our timing right. And